Hello, everyone. Welcome to GIA Knowledge Session. GIA's Knowledge Session is a series of webinars that are presented by our researchers and educators. So today, we're very happy to have Dr. Jennifer Stone-Sundberg. Dr. Sundberg is the technical advisor of GIA Education. She's going to talk about laboratory-grown colored gemstones, crystal growth methods. Before we get started, a couple things for you to pay attention to. So all the participants are muted by default, and you have a Q&A box along the bottom of your screen. You can type in your questions. By the end of the presentation, we'll have a QA session. So Dr. Sundberg will have an opportunity to answer your questions. Then after the presentation, you will get a survey email. And in the email, you will also have a link to a YouTube video of today's webinar. So you can go back and revisit the webinar as whenever you want. So now I will pass the microphone to Dr. Stone-Sundberg.
Hello, everyone. My name is Jennifer Stone-Sundberg. And before joining GIA, first as a consultant and next as an employee, my background was in solid state crystal growth, particularly for the high technology industry, for solid state lasers and for substrates. Essentially, what I'm going to cover for you today are the main colored stones that we have synthetics for, the ruby, sapphire, alexandrite, and spinel, and the crystal growth methods that have been used for these. This is a collection of some flame fusion grown crystals, and we'll revisit these a little bit later. We're going to define laboratory grown or what have been called synthetic gemstones for a long time. We're going to look at where these things are in the marketplace. We'll look at a bit of the history, and then we'll go through each of the main colored stones that we have these laboratory grown alternatives for one by one. Okay, so first question, laboratory grown gems, what are these? Essentially, these are materials that we have made, and they have the same structure and the same composition as their mined gem counterparts. So here I have a picture of a natural ruby on the left, and then I have a synthetic ruby on the right, both in their rough and cut form. And in the middle is just a picture showing the structure of alpha aluminum oxide, which is what the structure both of these have. So since these two crystals have the same structure and the same composition, they have essentially the same physical properties in chemistry. Now, knowing that, in order to avoid deception, the Federal Trade Commission states that these products must have the term laboratory grown, laboratory created, or the manufacturer name dash created, or a term like synthetic preceding the gem name. So for example, we could call this picture here of this Vernoy grown crystal, laboratory grown ruby, laboratory created ruby. We could call it Java created ruby because that's the company that made it, or we could call it synthetic ruby. And these are not to be confused with imitations. Imitations are not the same as laboratory grown gems. These are natural or manufactured items that just look like, resemble a particular mined gem, but they have a completely different composition and structure. So for example, you could have a natural imitating another gem, for example, red spinel, whether it's mined or whether it's laboratory grown, can substitute for ruby. On the right here, we have a picture of a color change synthetic sapphire that's substituting for alexandrite, or you can have any number of other combinations of materials, doublets, foil backs, plastics, glass that can look like a mined gem, but in fact, since they are not the same material and structure, they are deemed an imitation. And when we look at the jewelry marketplace, we can appreciate the fact that these laboratory grown gems have been around for more than a century. And the main place that they fit into the market is an affordable alternative to mined gems. However, more recently, we're starting to see different jewelers and synthetic gem makers using buzzwords such as ethical, environmentally friendly, and sustainable when they talk about these products. If you are a gem cutter, one thing that's nice about this laboratory grown material is you can cut all sorts of fancy cuts and you don't have to compromise the cut in order to maintain weight. But what is very essential for the gem industry is to be able to clearly identify these synthetics. Now, separating synthetics from mined gems is actually not that difficult for the most part. Because even though they have the same basic composition and structure, there are key differences. In particular, the trace element signatures can be vastly different between these two. And also the inclusion scenes are usually a pretty dead giveaway between a natural mined gem and its laboratory grown counterpart. And here we can see on the left, we can see a laboratory grown ruby with some bubbles in it. And on the right, we can see some platinum crystals in a flux grown emerald that's coming from the crucible material. And just as we have with mine gems, with the laboratory grown gems, we have a wide variety of quality. So for example, on the left, we have a Remora flux grown synthetic ruby in both in the rough and the cut. And on the right, we have a flame fusion grown synthetic ruby, rough and cut. And we'll go into the differences between these two and why these two particular versions of a laboratory grown ruby will actually cost quite a bit. They'll have a very different price point in the marketplace. And so when we are looking at the marketplace, we have here, we can see that, for example, all of these different crystal growth methods that I have listed on the left, we are going to define and go through in detail. But we can see that for flame fusion, these materials are very inexpensive per carat for a cut gem versus some of these other techniques further down like hydrothermal and flux, where the price point ends up considerably higher. So the demand for the laboratory grown, here we can see examples of a laboratory grown blue sapphire, laboratory grown emerald, laboratory grown pink sapphire, and some laboratory grown ruby. You know, people desire these gems, and the price points for the natural counterparts can be, you know, too high of they're not able to afford them. So these end up fitting nicely into the marketplace for some people. And those particular gems, they can be set, you know, in gold or silver or platinum. They can be set alongside of cubic zirconia or mined diamonds. But beyond the jewelry market, the vast majority of the market for these laboratory grown crystals, these gem varieties, in fact, have to do with the high-tech industry. So here I'm showing you two major drivers of the crystal growth of synthetic sapphire. On the left is the very first concept of the point of sale window. When you go to the grocery store, for example, and you know your items are scanned over that clear glass window so that the barcode can be read, on top of that glass is a very thin piece of sapphire. And so in this left image, you can see the piece of glass and then you see the round disc that's adhered to the glass. That's actually a piece of sapphire to keep the window scratch free for years. Whereas if you had a piece of glass, it would stay scratch free for maybe a couple of weeks. And then on the right, we have a synthetic ruby crystal and a laser rod. And the solid state laser industry has driven the perfection of the growth of many of these crystals that we're going to talk about. Beyond just, you know, lasers and point of sale windows, we can find these synthetic sapphires in a vast array of products. For example, here we have the lenses on smartphones and that white flash on the back of your smartphone. And then we have the LED light bulb, the white light bulb here in the center. Now, the synthetic sapphire industry is actually a $6 billion a year global industry, with more than 99% of it going towards products like these. And the synthetic, the portion of the market that goes for synthetic gems is much under 1% of the total market. And this is a growing market, about 6 to 7% annual growth rate. And one other thing to mention, even here at GIA, we have employed a crystal growth company to grow some sapphire that's specifically doped with the trace elements that we find in natural stones, so that we can use these to calibrate our instrumentation in our colored stone services. Okay, so let's get down to the actual crystal growth methods. First of all, it should be understood that this is a high barrier to entry industry. It's not simple or inexpensive to get into synthetic crystal growth. And then we need to talk about the different growth methods. Since not all materials melt congruently, that would mean they would have a sharp melting temperature, we need to look at different types of growth methods. So if something has a sharp melting point, you can grow it directly from the melt, sort of like you can make ice cubes from water. But the temperature for these materials that we're interested in can be very high, like over 2000 degrees Celsius. Now, there are a number of materials that do not have sharp melting points, and we deem these incongruently melting materials. And when you heat them up, they will decompose, and you will have a couple of different materials. And it, you know, for example, if you've ever tried to melt sugar, it does not go to a nice melt. It turns into like a brown caramel. That is something that's decomposing as you're trying to melt it. So we have to employ different methods to grow these incongruently melting materials. So for example, the more complex the chemical composition, generally the more difficult the crystal growth, because as you can have these multiple phases possible. So here on the bottom, I have those chemical formulas for the gem materials that we're going to look at. So if you have aluminum oxide versus, which is corundum, versus magnesium aluminum oxide, which is spinel, versus beryllium aluminum oxide, which is your chrysoberyl or alexandrite, versus beryllium aluminum silicate, which would be your beryl or emerald. All of these are congruently melting except for the beryl. And you can see that has the most complex composition of them all. So when we talk about these direct growth methods where we are reliant upon a sharp melting point, we can see that the crystals formed from them take on a variety of shapes and sizes. And we will look at each one of these particular methods more in depth to understand where these shapes come about and the qualities of the crystals produced from them. Now, for those that are incongruently melting, the ones that don't have sharp melt points, we have to use some sort of a solution to grow them, whether we're using a flux or whether we're using a water solution for hydrothermally grown. On the bottom, I just have some other crystal growth methods that are indirect that are employed elsewhere, whether it's for diamonds, which we're not going to talk about today, or for laboratory grown moissanite. The sublimation growth. And actually moissanite has a large high technology industry behind it as well. And one thing to mention with solution growth is you can still grow the directly melting materials, let's say corundum for sapphire or ruby. You can still grow these in solution. And one big advantage of growing them in solution is you can do the crystal growth at a much lower temperature. Okay, so now the impurities of the color, those particular impurities, they can either enter the crystal directly while you're growing the crystal, or they can be diffused into the crystal post-growth. And whether we're talking about laboratory grown or mined gems, you know, these two processes take place. Now, if you happen to be a crystal grower and you're growing something directly from the melt, you need to know a couple things about the crystal and the impurity, or we would call it a dopant, that you're trying to put in it. Let's say chromium in aluminum oxide to make a laboratory grown ruby. You need to understand how that dopant fits into the aluminum oxide lattice. And so you need to understand that K value or that distribution coefficient in order to properly grow a crystal with the correct amount of impurity that you want. And on the right, I have the expressions for if you're going to do a post-growth diffusion. And here's just a little bit of explanation behind these two different ways of introducing impurities in your crystal. So let's step back in time. The history of laboratory grown gems. Many of you have, you know, read all of these different accounts, for example, about how the first synthetic ruby was realized by Marc Antoine Gaudin back in 1837. However, there was no commercially available laboratory grown ruby until Auguste Verneuil, using the flame fusion method, filed his patents and started his production. In fact, the production, he worked with somebody named Hran Deja Viridjian, who started a factory in France and then moved it over to Switzerland about 10 or 15 years later. Now, when we talk about the first synthetic examples of spinel, emerald, and alexandrite, in the time period between 1845 and 1858, Jacques-Joseph Ebelmann was the one who was experimenting with growing a lot of these different materials in a borax flux. However, when we talk about the first commercial versions of these crystals, we go back first to Verneuil for first commercial spinel. In 1908, one of his students was trying to produce blue sapphire, and he kept adding magnesium oxide to the flame fusion growth, and he ultimately created spinel. And once they realized that, you know, they started commercially producing it. Now for synthetic emerald in the 20s to about 1940, there were many gem quality crystals produced in using the flux method in Germany by Richard Nakin, or in the IG Farben factory, and also in the United States, Carol Chatham in 1938 was successful and then started commercializing. For synthetic alexandrite, 1971, that's when the first crystals were made commercially available by Creative Crystals in California. On the right, you can see an image of some of these very first synthetic flux rubies that were grown by Fremy and Verneuil before Verneuil perfected the flame fusion process. So synthetic ruby or laboratory grown ruby is a pioneer both for synthetic gems as well as the high technology crystal growth industries. Not only was it the first laboratory gem made available, but it was also the very first solid state laser material. And both of these pushed forth crystal growth technology to develop many new techniques, but also to better understand the processes. So let's start with Verneuil or flame fusion. Like I mentioned before, the invention of the flame fusion process and all of the patents were filed in 1902. And this was a little bit after the Geneva ruby, which also appeared to have been grown in a similar fashion, roiled the industry in 1885. These man-made rubies were being sold as naturals in Europe at that time. And there's really no information as to who was responsible for these particular synthetic gems that were in the market. So what we can see here on the left is somebody in the modern day flame fusion factory managing several crystal growth stations. And then on the right, we see a sketch of Verneuil's torch. And just for your information, today, one single operator can manage something like 150 of these stations at once. And these crystals grow at a rate of, you know, within a couple of hours, you can have an ingot. So here is a diagram of the torch showing where you're introducing the gases and the very finely ground alumina powder with whatever dopants you need in order to get the color you achieve. And then that powder is very uniformly metered out into the flame below. And then you start collecting melt on a pedestal with a seed so that you can ensure the orientation of the crystal. And on the right, you can see a formed ingot or boule of the synthetic, whether this is spinel or sapphire, I'm not sure, on the right. So here I have pictures of a whole bunch of the colors available for the laboratory grown flame fusion sapphire on the left and of the laboratory grown flame fusion spinel on the right. So these, the sapphire ones split from the heavy strain. In fact, you intentionally split them so that they won't fracture when you go to processing later on. The reason that these particular crystals have so much strain in them is during that growth process, there is a very large temperature gradient on the crystal as it's growing. And these ingots, they're about 20 millimeters in diameter. And most of these are about 50 or 60 millimeters in length. You can grow longer and you can grow ones with a larger diameter, but for the most part, this is the size that you will find. So how can you distinguish these from the mined counterparts? Well, in the flame fusion grown material, you're generally going to see a curved striae. You're going to see this color banding here. And then also you're going to see bubbles. And one thing that we're going to hear over and over again as we go through these melt techniques are, you know, bubbles are prevalent. So that is one very clear way of distinguishing from the natural. Okay, so here are some interesting looking crystals. These I found in Tucson in 2019 when I was going through the different shows. I thought they were very interesting looking. And in 2019, there were a lot of bicolored mined gems being offered. And I found it interesting that on the laboratory grown side, you know, they were participating in this trend as well. So here is an example of one of the cut gems from those types of ingots that we saw in the previous slide. And when you see the image at the right, the microphotograph taken by Nathan Renfro, you can see undissolved material in there as well as bubbles. You know, here again, very characteristic of the flame fusion method. So now we're going to go on to our next melt technique. So the pooling method of crystal growth, or the Czochralski method. This method was invented accidentally by Jan Czochralski in 1916, a Polish scientist who happened to be in Germany at that point. He accidentally dipped his pen in a crucible full of molten tin. And as he pulled his pen up, he noticed a trail of the tin following it. And what he did after he noticed this bit of tin that froze off of the point of his pen, he determined that it was single crystal. And that was the birth of the Czochralski method. This method has been fundamental in solid state laser development, as also in the silicon industry. And on the bottom, you can see the basic stages. You have a crucible, you put your raw material in it, you melt it, then you lower a seed into it, and then you start extracting that seed, usually with some rotation. And then you can see the ingot that's forming as the melt level drops. And then the last image, you see a fully grown crystal. And on the right, here are some of the initial Czochralski grown synthetic ruby and sapphire that were produced in the 1960s by the Linde division of Union Carbide. And the longest of these is only 10 centimeters. On the left here, we have a schematic. It's a very old schematic. In fact, it shows a glass bell jar around the growth apparatus, but it really nicely shows the components that make up these furnaces, these growth stations, showing you that we have an inductive coil for heating. That inductive coil, it couples with your metal crucible, and your metal crucible is generally iridium, to produce the heat so that you can melt the material inside. And it shows, you know, the crystal seed position, and to all of the ceramics involved. And on the right, in the center, you can see two crystal growth stations that are actively growing using the Czochralski method. On the right is a completed spinel crystal bowl grown in a station just like these. So let's look a little bit deeper into those growth stations. So on the left, you can see it doesn't look very shiny and nice, but that crucible, that gray metal that's dull on the side, is 100% iridium. That crucible is about 12 inches tall by about 8 inches in diameter, and that's probably about $250,000 worth of iridium. On top of it, you have some refractories, some ceramics made out of either aluminum oxide or zirconium oxide, and then on the top of it, there's an iridium cone. Now, you can have any number of arrangements of these ceramics to control the heat during the growth. Now, that crucible and its afterheater, that bit of ceramic on top with the iridium cone, gets placed inside that inductive coil that you can see in the center picture. And that, that inductive coil is plumbed with some cooling water. And then also the gas, the atmosphere that you want to grow your crystal in, that's plumbed through the bottom. And then you see inside the coil is a quartz sleeve. And then you just place the crucible and some more ceramics inside of that. And then you cap it off at the end on the right with that aluminum bell jar that also has water cooling in it, because we're going to grow, for example, synthetic corundum at 2040 degrees Celsius. Okay, so now that you have everything in the growth station, we need to seed the growth. So on the left is an example of a synthetic sapphire seed crystal. And you're going to attach that to the extracting arm that's right above the bell jar in that center picture. And then you grow the crystal for however long it takes. On the right, you see a crystal growth operator harvesting a ruby crystal that the intention of that one is for laser rods. Now, that particular crystal probably took about 10 days to grow. And the cool down time is incredibly long for these, several days, because you want to ensure that the crystal is as strain-free as possible and that you're not going to have cracking as you pull it out of the furnace. Okay, so here are just some pictures to show you some of the materials. So again, on the left, we have some of those very early synthetic ruby and sapphire grown with Czochralski. That was when Lindy was involved in the synthetic, the laboratory-grown gem business. In the middle, we have some more crystals, much larger crystals that were grown also by the Union Carbide Corporation. And we have an array of faceted stones that came from materials that they grew through different times, starting in the 80s. And then on the right, we have some synthetic cobalt doped spinel, and you can see the gem perched on top of that one ingot with a really vivid blue color. So how can we distinguish Czochralski material from mined gems? Well, again, we're going to look for growth striations. And here on this particular crystal, we can have dislocations. We can have these low angle grain boundaries that show up. Now, for the most part, the Czochralski corundum crystals are relatively inclusion free. You can definitely have a lot of bubbles if the crystal is grown too quickly or you have some disturbance while the growth is happening. But a lot of times, you know, you're going to mine for the very clean material to cut, let's say, a laboratory grown gem from. But still, you can find these little bubbles. Also, the bubbles can have these ring-like features around them. So let's move on to the next crystal growth technique, the Karopolis crystal growth technique. This is probably a new word for some of you who are familiar with Czochralski or flame fusion grown, but this is a method that was developed in 1926 The goal was to make larger crystals than was possible with Cherkovsky. You have some limitations with these Cherkovsky crystals where you're pulling them out of the melt. So in this particular crystal growth method, you are cooling through the seed to the melt that's in the crucible in a setup that's in a lot of ways very similar to a Cherkovsky growth station. You can still have rotation of the crystal as it's growing, but there's no extraction while the growth process is taking place. And because of this, you have much, much lower strain in these crystals. And in fact, this method was used for growing crystals all the way up to 300 kilograms. When a couple of years back, I visited a laboratory grown gem manufacturer, and I was surprised to see this Coropolis ingot sitting there on the desk. And it turns out that they were faceting synthetic gems from this material as well. So here are some pictures of the Coropolis grown ruby and pink sapphire produced. And we took some of these back to the lab, and we could see some of the same characteristics that we see in the other melts. So we see curved lines, we see gas bubbles and elongated gas bubbles. Another growth technique, the edge-defined film growth, and we'll also talk about another one that's very similar, Stepanoff. This is a shaped crystal growth method. Here, what we're doing is if you look at the picture on the left, we have some sort of a die, something that's going to define the shape of the crystal as you pull it up. So it's another pull method. As you see the melt at the top of the die, and then you extract the crystal up, it's going to take on the shape of the die. So you can make tubes, hollow tubes, and you can make flat sheets, for example. And this is mainly used for protective windows. And you can see a close-up of the top with the seed still in it, in the middle. And on the right, you can see what one of these full-size crystals as grown looks like. Very similarly is the Stepanoff method. Stepanoff was the edge-defined film growth, and Stepanoff were both developed independently. Edge-defined film growth in the United States in the 60s. By Harry Lebel, and then Stepanoff in the former Soviet Union developed his technique between 1958 and 1970. But what we found at this same synthetic gem manufacturer is we found Stepanoff crystals, synthetic ruby Stepanoff. And so you can see the sheet there on the left, and you can see some of the cut stones on the right. We also took some of these back to the lab to take a look at what we could see. And again, we see our color zoning, we see our curved striae, and we see a mixture of round and elongated bubbles. Now we're going to look at a variety of gradient freeze techniques. So in this method, you're going to take powders and you are going to sinter them either into a rod and suspend the rod and heat one end of it to start a melt process. Or in this method called the Bagdasarov method or HDSM method, you are going to sinter the material in this vessel or crucible here that's made out of, in this case, molybdenum. And then you are going to translate that crucible through the heat source. In this instance, it's an RF coil that's coupling to your metal crucible. So there are many varieties of gradient freeze, Bridgman, Stockbarger, et cetera. But in the synthetic gem industry, mainly we're going to see what's called floating zone or this Bagdasarov method. So when visiting that same synthetic gem manufacturer in 2017, I also was surprised to see not only the Coropolis and the Stepanoff grown synthetic ruby, but I also found some of this HDSM Bagdasarov material as well. They had alexandrite and ruby being offered. So you can see what the ingot, part of the ingot from that vessel looks like, as well as what this cut gems look like. And here again, we inspected some of this material back in our lab. And what was kind of interesting about this is you could definitely see grain boundaries. So the crystallization here was not quite as good as with some of these other methods. And you can also see, again, elongated bubbles, some of them looking a bit like tadpoles. So now we're going to talk about the floating zone method, or when it was initially invented, it was more referred to as the float zone method. So both terms are used in the synthetic gem industry. Floating zone is the term used, so that's what I'm going to use here on out. And what you can see on the right is a diagram showing the sintered rod that is not in a crucible. And you can see the heat source, the RF coil, sort of a little more than halfway up. So you're going to translate that rod through that heat source to slowly melt and crystallize the material. You can perform this method horizontally, vertically, and the heat source can be an induction coil, or you can use other sources such as infrared, an infrared source, or even laser light. So again, floating zone, we see this example in the middle with bubbles. So this is where we have a little bit of interest going on. So the Bagdasarov method, or HDSM, is characterized as floating zone in some circles. But traditionally, the floating zone material that entered the synthetic gem market was the material grown by Seiko starting in the 1970s. They grew synthetic ruby, synthetic sapphire in a variety of colors, as well as alexandrite. So, but today, if you look for some floating zone synthetics, you're going to find them being offered by this company called Tyrus. So again, the characteristics inclusions that you're going to see are bubbles and some growth zoning. Here are some, more examples of the Seiko crystals, the faceted crystals on the top, and the Bagdasarov HDSM crystals on the bottom. And when we look inside the Seiko material, we see a roiled internal structure, and some very small bubbles can be found. And you can contrast that to what we saw a couple slides back for the HDSM material. So there are definitely some differences even between these two that may be represented both as floating zone. So let's switch gears. We finished with our melt growth techniques, and now we're looking at our solution techniques. So we have flux and hydrothermal. So these are for our materials that do not melt congruently, or we're trying to use this method to create a quote, more natural looking synthetic, or we're just simply trying to grow the material at a lower temperature. So this particular process grows much, much more slowly. So sometimes these growths go on for, in the case of hydrothermal, like the barrel crystals that you see on the bottom, about 1 month of crystal growth time. And for the flux grown, for example, the crystals up top, you can see a flux grown emerald rough, sapphire, blue sapphire rough, and ruby rough. And you can see some cut gem examples, as well as a cut alexandrite, synthetic alexandrite that was grown through the same method. Now those can grow for up to a year. And with the amount of time invested, you're going to end up having much lower strain, and you're going to have, you're not going to have bubbles, and you're going to have inclusions that might be called more natural looking. And these are the materials. This is why, if you remember the price slide, these materials demand a higher price than the much more quickly grown, much higher strain, potentially with bubbles in them, melt methods. So here, this is an old schematic that shows both hydrothermal on the left and flux on the right, what the furnaces would be for synthetic emerald. So let's take a look inside of these materials. So on the left, we can see the fingerprints in a flux-grown alexandrite. Right, we can see the icicles in a flux-grown emerald. So that flux material, whatever it is, that solution that you use to dissolve the raw material of the synthetic gem you wish to create, little bits of that material will end up being inside of these crystals. Now, here on the left, you can see actual crystals of the metal from the crucible that have formed while the synthetic gem crystal was forming. And then on the right, you can see another characteristic, wispy veils that you can find in these types of materials. Now, for hydrothermal, this particular method, since you're using water, you're going to have some slightly different inclusions than you're going to find in the flux grown. So here is a very characteristic inclusion in a synthetic hydrothermally grown emerald, a nailhead spicule. And on the right, we can see, you can still have crystals that will grow inside of these laboratory grown crystals. And here we have phenakite crystals showing up in this particular example. Some other things that we will find in these hydrothermal materials, a chevron growth and a liquid fingerprint. So now that we have gone through the different crystal growth methods and we've looked at a whole array of inclusions, now here's the other part. We can separate these materials via their trace element chemistry. The trace element chemistry is going to be quite different for a number of reasons. When gems grow in the earth, they're going to have certain chemicals coming from, or certain trace elements coming from the environment that they're in. When you grow these materials in the laboratory, those other trace elements are generally not going to be present. You have a high control over the materials that you are putting in the furnace. So, but you are going to get different trace elements that show up. For example, your crucibles are going to leave potentially signatures in the form of gold, platinum, iridium, tungsten, or molybdenum, depending upon what your crucible material is. Your refractories might end up a little bit in there. So you might see some zirconium or yttrium, which is used to stabilize a lot of the refractories. Your flux, all of these different elements that are listed here are traditional ones that are used in an array of the different fluxes. Another way that you can distinguish some of the flux-grown synthetic emeralds from mined emerald is the flux will have no water. When you can melt bits of natural material to try to have a better representation of the trace elements that you would find normally in the mined gems. However, it becomes tricky to grow crystals when you start putting extra materials in there, and sometimes the quality can be greatly reduced. So to wrap up, we are going to just summarize for each of the synthetic gem types. So here we have a picture of a section of a Czochralski grown synthetic blue sapphire. So we have the rounded portion showing the outside of the as-grown crystal, and then here's a slab that was cut out of it. So we see we have multiple methods applied to the single metal oxide. The melting point is incredibly high, so this makes it challenging to grow, but also, you know, we do have many melt techniques that are applied to this material, and in fact, melt techniques that were developed specifically for this material. We can grow it both in flux or hydrothermal situations. The industrial applications have resulted in the development of many of these growth techniques so that we can have all of these different shapes and sizes, crystal purity, the best crystal structure that we can accomplish. And as we mentioned before, this is about a $6 billion a year global industry. Synthetic spinel, we also can employ multiple growth methods. This one also melts congruently. The melt temperature is higher than sapphire, so it melts at 2,135 degrees Celsius, which actually limits its growth in its true MgAl204 form. You can grow it alumina rich, which can be done both with flame fusion and Czochralski. However, you know, without it being strictly MGAL-204, is it truly a laboratory grown spinel, or is it more, you know, since the chemical form is a little bit different, that does make it less of a true laboratory grown alternative. Also, this can be grown flux and hydrothermally. Also, it has an array of industrial applications as well. Synthetic chrysoberyl, or if we dope it with chromium, alexandrite, also multiple growth methods. And here on the right, we have a picture of an entire crystal just for synthetic alexandrite laser rods. So this has an array of applications as well in the high-tech sector, as well as a synthetic gem material. Again, you can use multiple growth techniques. Synthetic beryl, lastly, this one is the one that we have described that is not congruently melting. So we are forced to use either flux or hydrothermal. And again, we mentioned that the flux grown does not contain water. And here are some of the main fluxes used in growing these particular crystals. And with that, thank you very much for joining me. And this is a close-up picture of that cobalt spinel gem that was in there a couple slides back. And with that, we can go to the question and answer.
Yeah, thank you, Jennifer. That was a lot of information to take in. So we got some interesting questions. I will go down the list and I'll pick some questions for you to answer. The first one, is color-changing sapphire a rare natural gemstone, or all of those are lab-grown?
Well, color-changing sapphire, to my knowledge, the only color-changing sapphire we've seen is some vanadium-rich material, and I don't think there's very much of it, and I don't know how well characterized it is. But I don't think that the material, the color change material that has been grown synthetically was not grown to be a laboratory grown alternative to that. I think it was more the desire to have an alternative to alexandrite, so it would function as an imitation. But there definitely is some very vanadium rich natural sapphire out there that does to kind of a purple green color change.
Good. Next question. As an average retail jeweler, using only 10 or 30 magnification loop, are there reliable identification features that we can use to determine whether the stone is lab grown or natural?
I would say, it depends. If you are well trained in looking for the bubbles and looking for characteristics of flux or looking for the curved growth striae, those are some dead giveaways. However, you might encounter a material that might be particularly clean and it might be very hard to identify it properly. But if you can find those round bubbles or elongated round bubbles, then you can be quite certain that you have encountered a synthetic.
Next question. So why yellow sapphire cannot be made from using iron 3+? Not sure whether it can be made with that or cannot. He's asking whether why it cannot be made from using iron 3+. And are color centers possible to be incorporated into the crystal during the crystal growth process?
Well, let me see. Yes, you can definitely have color centers induced in a synthetically grown crystal. Whether it comes out of the furnace that way or whether you post-growth treat it, because you can control for a melt growth, you can control the atmosphere that the crystal is encountering. So you can have either a highly reducing atmosphere or a highly oxidative atmosphere or, anything kind of in between. So yes, as far as the color centers, as far as the iron, trying to get iron dissolved in your melt and trying to grow a synthetic crystal with a high amount of iron is actually quite challenging. But the very specific question about the iron 3+, honestly, I don't think I can answer that very, very clearly, except, just from personal experience, it is quite challenging to get a high level of iron in a synthetic crystal growth.
The next one. What are the criteria that determine the prices of various lab-grown rough material and cut gems?
Well, it's the complexity of the growth, the length of time of the growth. For example, if you're doing flame fusion, like I mentioned in the presentation when we saw that picture of the gentleman sitting in front of a bunch of stations, you can literally have one operator man about 150 of those stations, and each one of those stations can potentially turn around a couple crystals a day. So in a single day, you can produce, hundreds, if not 1,000 crystals in a factory like that. Now, if you're doing a Czochralski crystal growth, it's going to take days to weeks to even months to grow one crystal. And then when you get to the solution methods, you're going to take, for hydrothermal, pretty much 1 month is a standard growth time for the cycle there for the synthetic barrel. And then for the flux grown, some of those, the furnaces are buttoned up and they leave it for a whole year before opening it up. And they don't know what they're going to get. They don't seed those for the most part. And, so the yields can be very unpredictable and you may not have as much to work with. So that's part of what dictates the price as well as the appearance. So those flux grown and hydrothermally grown materials are generally going to be, a bit lower strain. And so they're going to have a more quote natural appearance to them. And so they demand a much higher price than the rapidly grown, melt-grown materials, particularly the flame fusion.
Okay, let's move on to the next question. For synthetic gems, obviously impurities were added in to mimic what is in the natural gems.
Yes.
What other non-natural impurities have been added or for different colors or different reasons? Does that happen?
Well, you can certainly come up with, more exotic colors. For example, if you remember those ingots, those striped ingots of the flame fusion grown that I had picked up in Tucson, that one, the gem that was cut, that was half kind of a teal blue and half purple. Well, that one had a combination of cobalt and chromium in it. So you're not going to find a mined gem that's going to have a composition like that. So yes, you can put, just as long as the lattice will accept that impurity trace element, you can put some different things in there to get, more exotic colors. Does that basically answer the question?
I think so.
Okay.
Yeah. Next one. This is about barrel growing. Mm-hmm. So is Czochralski method is used for growing barrel? Is one growth method better than another, or is it more complicated than that?
Well, if you remember the barrel, that one was the silicate and with beryllium and aluminum. And so that one was too complicated that one does not melt congruently. And since it doesn't melt congruently, you cannot use a direct melt method. You have to use a solution growth. So that excludes Chakrovsky. So emerald will only, you will only find it being grown either hydrothermally or flux grown. Was there a second part to that question?
No, that's the question for that. Yeah, there was one question on the top of the list I forgot to mention is what caused the chevron pattern?
The chevron pattern, I personally am not as familiar with, the solution growth methods as I am with the direct melt growth methods. But I know in a Chakrovsky grown crystal, I've seen a chevron type pattern form as well. I guess I'm gonna have to say, I don't know. And I guess I don't wanna guess too much in case I go down a wrong path, but yeah, that's some things that I think we could try to answer more long-term if the person wants to forward a question, maybe we can address it separately.
Okay, there are still a lot of interesting questions, but I will get to the last one for Jennifer today. Can you get synthetic aquamarine to have more color saturation than natural ones?
I would think that you could. You can certainly have an array of color of aquamarine from the either hydrothermal or flux grown, and as you can very carefully control the chemistry and the trace elements present that would dictate the color, maybe you could, kind of spike the color in some way or another with your choice of trace elements that you put into the melt.
Well, I do see another one. I think it's quite important, so I will add that one in. So usually what magnification power you need to see these features that addressed in this presentation?
I would say generally 10x is generally pretty good for a lot of them, but I think a loop, you might have a hard time finding some of these things well. So I think a microscope would be a better way to go. And, to really see some of these features well, you might need to go, beyond 10x, maybe, 30x, 50x, to really be able to study them more carefully.
Well, thank you. I mean, we have many other questions. I think we can, definitely pass all your questions to Dr. Sundberg, and she can answer the questions as long as she gets the questions later after the presentation. So thank you for joining us. And for next week, we're gonna have something special for you. Instead of a webinar, we're gonna have an online discussion panel, which will be talking about the sustainability minefield. What does sustainability mean in jewelry, and why should we care? And we have a very big group of speakers next week with Melanie Grant and our very own GIA CEO, Susan Jux, Dr. Raquel Alonso Perez, Livia Firth, and Alexandra Moore. So see you next week.